They asked me to talk in English because the session will be recorded and available on the web afterwards, so we have a big audience watching us from above. Our talk this morning about two cases we did at Wunderkraut. My name is Dieter Beheet. I work with Wunderkraut, previously Crimson, from 2008. I started as a Drupal 6 developer, did some project management afterwards, but now I work there as a functional analyst, and that's really my thing, I feel now. My last presentation at the Drupal camp is some while ago in 2009. It was Drupal 6 was still hot, Drupal 7 was almost there, and it was something about a distro on Open News or something like that, or Open Publish. I even don't remember anymore. Projects later, and I'll show you one that we did at Wunderkraut today, last year actually. And yeah, the picture is just to add to our offers, so clients think that we have fancy work dresses, but that's obviously not the case. This is my colleague Pieter de Trooijer. I will introduce him so I don't have to switch microphones. He's our Director of Digital Solutions and Architecture, also at Wunderkraut for some time now, since 2012. He started also as a at the time I was project manager, and now evolved to program manager and solutions architect. And he's already playing with Drupal for a long time, since 2007. So, and he will do the second part of the talk. My part is about the architecture we did for a quite advanced platform we have by now. It's for the case of Voca. It's a Drupal 8 platform we've built. To know a bit more about Voca, who is Voca? For the people who wouldn't know, it's the Chambers of Commerce. So it's an organization here in Flanders which represents 18,000 companies. They are all member. They pay a certain fee to be a member, and they work in Flanders and in Brussels. They do a lot of networking between all of those companies. They exchange knowledge. They train all of their companies, so the expertise of all the companies in Flanders and Brussels rises. And they are also the voice of the local SMEs and larger companies in quite a lot of lobby dossiers with the government. And they contacted Wunderkraut to build a new version of their Voca.be. So at first it looked like, yeah, we need a new corporate website with news, events, people need to subscribe to events, with dossiers. Quite obvious it looked at first, but they had already done a business analysis with an external party, which was not Wunderkraut, and it seemed that they had also a future view on we want in the future some features which we call now matching or personalized services or communities, but at that time that were quite fluffy terms for us. So we started with the first basis for the platform being the Voca.be website. We chose Drupal 8 as a technology right away. We started in April 2016 with the basic Drupal. I'm not a technical guy anymore, so I don't know the real details. I still remember that a lot of contrib modules like an important one was some calendar views for all of their events. By now we are at 8.3.8 with the live version of this Voca.be platform, so great meantime. A big chunk of the work was CRM integration. It was a REST API which was already available at Voca. It was all based on a Microsoft a lot for them by an external party, and they use that on the website, or we use that on the website for their authentication of all their members. So every member of Voca has one or multiple logins. All the info of that member can be viewed on the website and can be updated, like what our preferences are, what topics do I want to receive news about. All of their events are created inside of the CRM, so they can track who wants to register to every event, and all the registration happens on the website and is pushed through the CRM to the CRM through the API to the CRM system. And at that time, we also were playing a lot with PatternLab. We used it for a Drupal 7 project, a big one for Johnson & Johnson. And now we wanted to test it with Drupal 8 too, because Twig was there. Can we integrate it more easily? Can we have a set of reusable components in our front end? So we used PatternLab at that time from the start, and which costed us some money because we had to pay for some research, obviously, but it paid off in the end, you will see. So that was the timeline. 16. So we started quite quickly with the development. And by December, we had a platform ready to enter content, which the client did. It took them a little longer than foreseen, but by March this year, we launched the new Voca.be website. But in the meantime, around summer last year, somebody else from the same Voca came to us with a project. Like, we do a lot of projects with Voca where we try to make our companies better and make the economy. And they said, we want to do a project called Welt, where we want to guide the companies, special companies, labor mediators, and unemployed people which find it difficult to train themselves in a certain skill. We want to do a project where we group all of these parties together, because we see that our companies have one question: how can I train a new employee on the job? And where can I find good people for these low education jobs, like doing cleaning services in a company, mowing the lawn, etc., etc. On the other hand, you have labor mediators, which are companies who know all of these people who don't find a job, who don't have that much of skills, who are not educated, and they want to know how can we better prepare these people and match these people to companies who are looking for these kind of people. So Voca did a project, and they saw that they wanted to use an online tool to help these companies and these labor mediators work together more. And so we did a trajectory with IMEC to see how that online tool had to look. So in July, and we knew that we wanted to start building in October. We had to launch in April because that project offline started with the first companies and labor mediators in April. And our quite tight schedule. But in the meantime, we were already building the Voca.be website. So the question at that time was, when we look at the features that Welt has, that specific project, we see that some of them are in common with the corporate website, which we are building or have already built by now. Like, the members of those companies need to be able to log in. They want to see some informational pages, but not all of them, of the Voca.be website. They want to see the subset of HR. The same for all activities. They are created in CRM. They are shown on the Voca.be website, but we want to see the subset for HR. Also, these they were going to be defined in CRM because all of their members are there. They can assign 10 members to each group. CRM was a quite handy tool for them. So if they define those groups there, why can't they be transferred to the website automatically? So when a member logs into the website, he sees that he's part of a Welt group. And also, and that was a lucky shot for us, the management of Voca decided that Voca should be known to the outside world and should always use the Voca orange as a color, because all of those projects internally, they had their own house style. Like Welt was more pinkish, and there are other Voca projects which were more green or blue, but the decision was made around that time that everybody needs to use the Voca orange color. So that were features which were in common with the corporate platform. On the other hand, there were new features, obviously, like we want a community online for those Weld members, where they can have a forum to chat about certain stuff, where they can ask questions about that specific HR topic. They wanted to see their personal growth, like at the start of each trajectory, a member company fills in a quite long list of questions. They see how good they score. They follow a trajectory with Voca, who give them training, etc., and who guides them through that whole Weld project. And at the end, they fill in the same questionnaire, and they can see if they grew on certain topics. So, quite a lot of new features. This is an example of that questionnaire, so people can see on a kind of diagram where they are compared to the group, etc., etc. All of that information, they also wanted that information in CRM because they wanted to do some data analysis on that afterwards. So again, we saw quite similar things, but not exactly the same like we already built or were building for the voca.be website. So by now, it was September 2016, we needed to decide. What do we do with that Weld project? They want an online tool. We know which features should be on there. Do we keep the one Drupal site which we are building for voca.be, and do we create some kind of subsection with all of those Weld features? Or do we convert that one Drupal site to a multi-site so they can share certain modules but have quite a different URL, etc.? Or do we keep the one voca.be website and do we create a totally different one for Weld? The last one we didn't go for, obviously, because if they want to share content, how do we build a system that syncs the content from therefore we needed quite some budget. Also, if that content is shared, it would be publicly available on two different URLs, the exactly same content, one for Voca, one for Weld. So SEO-wise, not such a good idea. Also, we needed some extra budget because then we would need a kind of single sign-on solution, or people should need to log in again on the two platforms, and we should sync all the profile updates to the two websites all of the time. And obviously, maintenance afterwards. As soon as you want to change something, you have to do it or on both or only on one, and etc., etc. So we didn't even think about the pros for that option. The other option could have been a multi-site, because then you could have a clean URL for the community, vocaweld.be. We could have very easily clean separation of the community environment because we have a multi-site, we could have another team, so it looks very, you are working within your Weld environment and not in the big voca.be environment. We could very easily select which modules are enabled or not enabled, etc. We would not be blocked by other modules which are not needed for our project. And maintenance would be good too. All the modules that we share, we maintain them once and it's okay for all of them, for the two multi-sites. However, for the content sharing, again, how would we do that? Would we share database tables in Drupal 6? It was quite easy to do, but in Drupal 8, again, with the shared content, we would have, again, two URLs for the same pages. So, the same goes for the SSO and login thing. So we went for the other solution, one Drupal where we have one Weld section. And I put section before between brackets because section is not a real concept in Drupal terms. And we, because yeah, maintenance again is quite okay. Login, you are on. Content sharing, a piece of content, and we could still create quite clean URLs because we voca.be, we add Weld, and then whatever is needed for the Weld features. A contra was a little bit, people lose the environment. For example, on the homepage of the Weld environment, I see an HR news article or activity. I click on it. Where do I go? I'm redirected to the voca.be news section where I see the detail page. Luckily, the back button is the most used one on everyone's browser, so we didn't care much about that. And also the fact that we still stayed in a kind of orange environment, people were not that lost when they started reading those shared content pieces. And we also had to think a little bit on how we would create such a section environment. But we fixed that with some routing and especially with URL structures, which indicated where a page belongs to. So in April 2017, we launched Welt on time, within budget, and with quality. And I think that's often that it happens that the three bullets are there, but I think we can, yeah, the choice of the architecture has played a big part here. 23 groups started immediately using that. Each group has 10 members, so 10 companies from Flanders started using it, so 230 members used it, and we didn't see that much bugs. People started really picking it up, and also the people at Voca who had to coordinate each group found it a nice tool to use. And it's not because it's my project that I say that, but because other parties in Voca saw it and they also wanted it. Like you have in Voca a quite known community called Plato. It's a community for people who become better as a manager in their company. Or Prio, which is a community within Plato who helps startups and scale-ups grow and connects them together. They also said, yeah, we want it too. We see that these communities or that community platform that's live already, we see that it works. So we, for each of those communities now, we have to twist and turn twice. We have to see how the community can fit the Welt community definition we already have, which we already have built. And it might be a little bit contra-intuitive, that you have to change some kind of business case maybe to fit a technical solution, but on the other hand it makes that all of your communities within Voca have a uniform approach. If somebody is part of a Brio platform and after a while he also joins a Welt project, he sees the same approach come back. On the other hand, we also have to twist and turn the platform from time to time. We have to see new communities, see their new requests, their new features, and try to update the platform to accommodate that. But always be aware, of course, of the moment where you start trying to push a square through a round hole, that we've seen also already. And that's something that we want to warn the people of Voca themselves, that they brief their communities internally to use the features as they are there. So that's the timeline where we are now, at the end, bottom right. In the beginning of this year, we did that analysis for those new communities, Plato and Brio. We've done some refactoring since April till August to find that those new, we also had to refactor specific implementation because one member of one company can participate to one Welt group, which is quite obvious. You don't participate in the same project in multiple groups. However, now that same person can also participate in a Welt group and in a Plato group, for example. Our setup was not prepared for that, so that was quite some refactoring. Also on the CRM side, because there they didn't match that yet until April. So both the CRM and the site had to be refactored, and now we are again, after a good deploy in the end of August, live and starting to add groups and communities for Plato and Brio. So by now, what did I say? We had 23 groups at the start with Welt only. Now we've doubled that. We are almost 50 groups live with Plato, Brio and Welt on our same platform. And in the meantime, the voca.be features are also still there live. So that's the result. We had three releases now. with a corporate section and community section, and we're already working on a new feature for new communities, specifically for the area of Limburg, where there's a community called CEO Limburg. And so the user base will grow, and we're sure that our platform will be able to extend and offer. Peter.
Hello. Okay. Good morning. Like Dieter said, I'm Peter. We don't have any communication problems due to that. Don't worry. I'm going to talk about the case for Lin Records, a project that we're currently still building. We're approaching the release, though. So let me first introduce Lin Records. Lin Records is part of Lin, a UK company, which is specialized in very high quality audio equipment. And they also had a record label on which they produced high quality releases for the people that bought their equipment, of course. When I say very high quality, usually these systems cost about the price of an average house in Belgium, so it's pretty expensive just for a hi-fi installation. So they aim for very good quality, and it had to show also on their website, also for their webshop, in which they were selling digital music to play on those systems. Digital music, why? Because CDs cannot contain such amount of data that they want to sell. So they want to sell studio quality music, which means that it's way too much to fit on one single disc. And therefore, a digital distribution system is a very good solution. Internet these days is not a problem. Certainly, if you can spend this much amount of money on an installation, you take the cost of bandwidth easily. Some things that are typical for these kind of music files, there are files, track files that take 15 gigabytes for one track only. That's studio master quality in 192 kilohertz recording. Some numbers, they have a turnover of about 30K every month. They have about 1,000 transactions and a 7 terabyte of storage, music file storage. 7 terabyte is not because there's that many releases. It's also every release is being offered in different qualities. So you have the studio master quality, and then you have four or five lower different kinds of quality. Depending on your budget, you can choose from either these. So they came to Wunderkraut, and so their initial request was, okay, we have a website in which we sell our music, and it's starting to show its age. It was 6 years old. The design was not responsive. The layout was very 2005 or 2010 style, so very busy and not very bright, and it didn't vibrate enough with the quality that they want to show. So they needed a redesign, and they also wanted to have a better management of the music or the product that they want to sell. So their e-shop should be revamped. And it also had to integrate with new systems for their reporting of digital rights, like Sabam that we have in Belgium, for people that buy the music, or sales reporting, VAT reporting, and that kind of thing. And why did they need to change it? Because actually, Lin Records, the label, was sold to Out Here Music, a Belgian company, and so everything had to be integrated in their systems. To go forward, because it was going out of the Lin systems from that point in time. As we were defining a new platform for the website, it also made sense to bring the Out Here Music webshop also on the same platform. It's not done yet. It's we just have this given as something that we take into account to build a platform rather than a single site, so that the web shop from out here can also be brought on the platform later on. The big difference between Outer Music is that Outer Music is selling physical goods. They're really selling records and CDs in their web shop. So there's two different approaches. One is selling physical goods, the other one is selling digital. They came to us in October 2016. We did a feasibility study first to see what is this going to cost, because the definition and the request was pretty vague. They didn't thought through all the implementation, all the details that for integrations with their own systems. So we had to discover which are these systems, are they good to continue further on, and so on. Once we did that, we started concept and design. I'll talk about it later, and then afterwards more technical analysis and architecture exercise, and then in May we started the development, and we're nearing the launch probably in October. So in the concept and design phase, we have typical activities. So we did some interviews with stakeholders to gather information. So stakeholders, the current Lean employees, for example, that are managing the shop, the people from out here that had to go to manage the shop in the future, some customers we also checked out about their experience. And then we started defining a couple of user personas, and we did the user journey mapping, and we started to map out all the features and functionalities for the site. Of course, information architecture was largely built on top of the existing architecture, because you have to be able to migrate at some point in time. You have, I think, 70,000 music files that we had to bring over to the new platform. So the information architecture has to have a certain mapping, of course, which you have to take into account. So in the architecture phase, and also part of the pre-analysis we did was to check, okay, we need to build a web shop for selling digital goods, which is a bit easier because you don't have to take into account shipping and all that kind of things. And we are abandoning a fully custom built system that is fully integrated with the Lean systems for bookkeeping and such, into a new solution for out here. So we had to dig a bit how things are done at Lean, and then how they want it to be done in out here. Conclusion was that a lot of the existing systems that are being used in out here would be better to be replaced by new systems, which we will also be building into the integration. An important factor was quick time to market, so we couldn't start an exercise in which we would take 2 years to develop a full integrated solution, because the transfer was already done from Lean Records. They were just only operating the shop for the remaining time. So out here has to take it over as soon as possible. So we had to make sure that we could do it as quick as possible. So don't do everything if possible. But anyway, full migration is needed. We have to take into account all the running discount actions that are on the web shop currently. We have to take into account all the users, all their purchase histories, and of course the music. An important factor for out here to go with our solution was that we would propose with Drupal. A big advantage is, of course, that there is no vendor lock-in, and they can, if they are unhappy, they can just move along, but we'll make sure that they never be unhappy. And of course, a limited budget for out here. This is starting a new business or a new line of business, so it's a big risk. You don't know if you can keep your visitors. You have to make sure that that you can grow your business, so it's a big risk. So they wanted to impose a limited budget to limit their risk as well. A limited budget also pays into helps to make a quicker time to market, because you have to gather solutions that take less time and money. So we went looking for e-commerce solutions at that point in time. So I'm talking now end 2016, beginning 2017. Of course, as Wundercraft being a Drupal shop, the first reflex could be, well, let's take it Drupal Commerce. At that point in time, Drupal Commerce is now just released as the, on the Drupal 8 version. But at that point in time, it was far from stable and also far from functionally complete. So there were some limitations that, like proper EUVT handling, that were a big obstacle. Discounting options were limited at the time, and payment gateways were also rather limited. So we would be needing to do a lot of custom coding, and a full e-commerce shop build is taking quite a lot of time because you have to implement everything. We looked also a little bit into Magento as Wundercraft is part of AppNovation, and AppNovation has a big group of Magento people. This could be also a solution, but it is indeed better than what we could have at that point in time from Drupal Commerce. But we were less familiar with the code base, and we preferred also to have a local, the client also preferred to have a local team developing. And the content management for news and extra information that you want to bring on the website to give the site a bit more body and also to help with SEO optimization, that was not that easy to set up. Also, like I said, we didn't have that much experience with Magento. Shopify was another option that we considered. Reason also because, like we said, we have to do it quickly and we have to try to reduce the amount of work that we have to put in. It's a good platform, you can set it up very quickly. We did a couple of concepts, but still you need some integration for a file hosting and selling solution. It is difficult to, you can make it your own, like design-wise, but still you see a very clear Shopify signature in the look and feel of the website. And also the costing model that they are using is not that ideal or not that because they have costing per transactions also on top of the costing that you have to do for your payment gateway on top of that. So you're losing already 5% of your revenue just by using that platform. So we started also to look into a combination of Drupal 8 with a platform like Shopify to make sure that we have the content easily managed and that you can make your pages and integrate it with the e-commerce part. This seemed very feasible, but still the costing model would be the same problem, and the file hosting, doing that in Drupal for this amount of files would be not that efficient. So our end conclusion of the discovery was that we would use Sendal. Sendal, we didn't know it before, but it became very quickly that it was clear that it was a very good solution. They have a very strong API. They have also a very good team that is very responsive on information requests and also even change requests if it fits their project plan, of course. And it also, it's not locking you in any kind of way. So you have your you have the system that allows you to sell goods on the on your website. They are just putting everything in layovers, in pop-ups. And you can just, you can choose your own payment gateways. There's a lot of possibilities there. You can do even your own file hosting if you want, if you can make it cheaper than what they're offering, of course. They have covered all the VAT handling, they have covered reporting, they have covered a number of imports. They even localized your experience, so you don't have to worry about that. And also, they had already built in the distribution of the files. They have they are all part of file managed in CDNs. And you don't have to worry about that either. And then also, for example, you can sell bundles of products, which makes sense for records, because records have tracks, and you can buy individual tracks, or you can buy the whole album at one go. So that's also a concept that fitted very well with the Lin Records case. But yeah, for Shopify there were plenty of integrations available, or easy and more advanced with Drupal, but for Sendout there is none. But as it's very API driven, and in Drupal 8 you have very good a very good architecture in place to integrate this, we started building a module in which we abstracted what was generic for a Sendout integration. So the idea is that you create an entity and you provide a number of fields, like a price field, a name field, an image field, a description, and you can configure any entity to be integrated in your Sendout web shop. So every time you create an entity of that type, you add a file to it, it gets synced to Sendout, and your product is available in your web shop. So this is a very easy way in the future. Once we get the project finished, we probably will also release this separate part of the project as a separate integration to provide another solution that people can use to easily build a web shop without Drupal Commerce. It's not that I have anything against Drupal Commerce, because I used it in the past, but at the point in time that we were developing, this was by far an easier solution to come up with. Today it might be a bit different, but still there is a lot of development to set up your shop in the case for some to do. Conclusion, this was a very interesting exercise because we were very constrained by the request that the client had. It pushed us further to not fall into our defaults to propose a Drupal solution. So we had to think outside of the box and get away from our Drupal solutions. And we discovered a number of possibilities. And integrations can be a good element to reduce your project cost, because if you don't have to reinvent everything, and you can make your project quicker and smoother. Of course, as long as the integrations don't interfere too much with your design or your experience on the website. So Sendout in that that aspect was very good covered, because they are actually staying out of your website. It's just any link that you create, they have a pop-up for your shopping basket, and your checkout process is running completely on top of your website instead of inside of your website. So invented elsewhere is a paradigm that we took into the development for Drupal 8 as well, and I think this can be extended also for projects in which you can develop new or get new experiences, which was also very interesting for our developers to work on. That's it for me. If there are any questions for Dieter or me, you can freely ask. Okay. Then I think it's time for a break.